Germany. How many kilometers north of Frankfurt?
About 200.
About 200. So for those of you who would like to go on Google Earth and on Google Maps and go look where it is, if you're interested in talking on decomposition techniques for large-scale optimization problems. Dr. Fisher, thanks a lot, and over to you.
Thanks, can you hear me? Okay, first my background, I'm a mathematician, so my field of research is mathematical optimization and in particular combinatorial and discrete optimization. That means that the optimization problems that we are interested in usually contain a lot of discrete decisions. That means we usually have for each possible decision that we make, we have a should I stay here?
So yeah.
I'm walking around so it could be a problem. I try to stay here. Okay. So for decisions that we make, we usually have only a finite set of choices. For example, yes or no, build or do not build, buy or do not buy, stuff like this. So this is the outline of my talk. I will start with an example problem, which is the wind park extension planning problem. This is a problem that we work on in a project right now. But in this talk, I will not give you any or not much details about this particular problem because it will only serve as an example for the stuff that I want to tell you. And my talk is mostly about methods, so algorithmic approaches to solving these kind of optimization problems. But afterwards, I will show you the mathematical optimization problem, and I will talk about this, essentially the main topic of my talk about the Lagrangian solution approach. And let's start with a small example. So let's start with the wind park extension planning problem. So what you see here is part of the Northern Sea, essentially. Here's Germany, that's Denmark. And the task of this problem is to construct new wind parks in the Northern Sea along with the connections, the energy connections from those wind parks to the onshore grid nodes. And in principle, it's in its most in its simplest form, you just have to find to decide which wind parks to build and which connections to build so that certain constraints are satisfied, and for example, that the overall construction is as cheap as possible. In this project, we are not interested in static planning, but in extension planning. That means the time horizon in which these wind parks are built is not very short, but it consists of several years, so the construction should take place until 2050 or so. Then it's an important part that all these wind parks are not built at once, but in multiple steps, such that certain intermediate goals have to be met. And well, this is probably the same for all optimization problems. The typical difficulties are those optimization problems are very large. They involve complex technologies, and in our case, we have multi-period planning, a multi-period planning problem. However, in this talk, I will only focus on the static planning problem, not because that's what we do in our project, but because just for the sake of this presentation. So that means I will make a lot of simplifying assumptions only for this talk. First of all, you only consider a single construction step, and you will assume that all those wind parks that you want to build are already built. What we focus on is the construction of the connections. That means you want to design the energy network. In particular, we will neglect a lot of technical details about the physical properties of energy transport. And in the end, it comes out that this problem is some kind of combined network design problem and capacity dimensioning problem. But let's start slowly. What are the decisions that we want to make? We want to decide which connections and hub nodes, not the wind parks, but the hub nodes, should be built, which technology to install, and we should install a sufficient capacity in terms of transportation capacity on those connections, such that the total construction cost is minimized and certain technical constraints are satisfied. So for example, there should be enough capacity so that all the energy produced by the wind parks can be transported to the onshore grids. So this is roughly the problem description. Now we come to the mathematical optimization model. For us, the network is just a simple graph with the nodes representing the wind parks, the hub nodes, and also the onshore grids. And the edges represent the potential power lines that you could build. And then we have certain decisions. First of all, we have to decide which hubs to be built and which connections to be built. And in mathematical sense, it means zero, do not build, one, build. And we have the dimensioning decisions. Which technology should be installed on the nodes and on the connections, and how many of them should be installed. The goal is to minimize the total cost. The total cost consists of several parts. For example, we have to pay a lot if we just build an offshore hub node, if we build an offshore connection, and we also have to build we have to pay something if we install certain technologies on those nodes and on these connections. If you put it all together, then we come up with a mathematical optimization problem, which is written like this. We want to minimize the total costs. Our decisions are discrete integral decision variables, which nodes, which hub nodes, and which connections to be built, and which technologies to be installed, such that certain technical constraints are satisfied. That means we are only allowed to install certain technology if the corresponding hub node, for example, is built in the is built, and there should be enough capacity so that the generated energy can be transported to the onshore grids. This kind of optimization model is well known. It's a so-called mixed integer linear program, and there's a lot of standard software that can be used to solve this problem. So if whenever you have a certain optimization problem of this kind, the first thing that you should try is use one of those state-of-the-art solvers. But more often than not, it turns out that the problems are just too big to be solved to optimality by these solvers. In fact, one has to say that these solvers usually solve these models to optimality. However, in practice, this is not something that you really need. Often, approximate solutions are sufficient because, well, the data is inexact anyway. So what we really want is we want short computation times, we want sufficiently good solutions, and this is what is somehow special for mathematical optimization. We want to know how good these solutions are. So even if they are not optimal, we want to find global bounds that certify the quality of the solutions that we found. We do not just want to hope that our solutions are good, we want to know it. And one possible approach for this is Lagrangian relaxation. So let's come to this approach. What is the idea? The idea is the following. So mathematicians like to write everything in fancy formulas like this. And suppose we are given an optimization problem of this kind. We minimize our objective function, and we have some set of easy decisions and some set of complicating constraints. Complicating constraints means if we remove these constraints, then the optimization problem becomes easy. Okay, removing constraints is in general not a good idea, because then the solutions that come out might not be feasible for the optimization problem. So the idea of Lagrangian relaxation is, instead of enforcing these constraints, we penalize the violation. And we end up with a related optimization problem that had almost the same objective function f of x plus the penalty costs, but we have only the easy constraints. I do not want to go into the details of this theory and of the solution approaches, but there's one important property of Lagrangian relaxation, and this is Lagrangian decomposition. If your problem happens to have a certain structure, so for example, we assume it has this structure, which means we have some decisions x1 and some other decisions x2, and those decisions are only coupled by some of those complicated constraints. If we remove these constraints, then the overall problem decomposes into several subproblems. One very easy problem because it's constant, one problem only depending on the decisions x1, and one subproblem only depending on the decisions x2. So we have simpler subproblems. Which also means that each subproblem only covers a certain structure of the overall problem. In our case, it could be the following decisions. One kind of decisions are the decisions which hub nodes and connections to be built. The other kind of decision is which technology should be installed on those hub nodes and connections. That means we have two sub-problems. One is a fixed charge network design problem. Just tell me how your energy network should look like. And the other sub-problem is the network dimensioning sub-problem. How many transformers and so on should be installed on which node and so on. These two problems are still, in theory, very hard problems, but it turns out that it can be solved efficiently in practice by state-of-the-art solvers. So what we get is we have an optimization problem that is significantly easier to solve, but it's only a relaxation. So easier to solve means there are standard methods, standard algorithms that can be used to solve the corresponding Lagrangian relaxation problem, for example, bundles. But it is only a relaxation. That means the solutions that we get out of this model are, in general, not feasible for the original optimization problems, so they must somehow be fixed, so that we find feasible solutions. Those solutions will not be optimal in general, but hopefully they will be good. The nice thing about Lagrangian relaxation is this approach provides global bounds. That means now we have some certificate about the quality of the solutions that we find by this method, which of course is in particular useful if those problems are too large to be solved by standard solvers. So let's go to a small example. And this example is not about a wind park expansion problem, but about a seemingly completely different problem. The reason is that we just at the beginning of the project and I do not have an example for all the technical details of this problem. But I have a nice example from a different field, in particular from telecommunication networks. It may look as if this problem is completely different to the wind park extension problem, but it turns out those two problems have many common aspects. The LFTX network design problem is to design an optical fiber network to connect internet providers with households. So you want to build up a high bandwidth telecommunication networks. And there are many practical difficulties that are similar to the design of energy networks. For example, you have huge investment costs. Building a new fiber connection means that you have to dig into the earth to put your cable in there, and this is quite expensive. Similar, if you want to build some offshore nodes, then this is very expensive. And the problem is very similar to the wind park expansion problem. First, we have the static network design problem, but how does my optimal telecommunication network look like? And you have also the extension planning problem, the evolution planning. So you want to construct this network in several steps. Now, from a mathematical point of view, if you look at the models, then you will see those two problems are almost the same. We just have different names for the same objects. Customers in the telecommunication network context are what are the wind parks in the energy network context. Distribution points are hubs. Central offices are onshore grids. Technologies are technologies, and so on. So from a mathematical point of view, those two problems really lead to the same optimization model. And therefore, we can hope that we can solve those models with the same methods. I told you that Lagrangian relaxation usually does not create optimal solutions, not even feasible solutions, and we have to do a little bit about this. So let's look at this example. What can we do for this specific problem? Lagrangian relaxation solves a couple problems. We get feasible solutions for each of our sub-problems, but those solutions are not compatible, not completely compatible. So we need heuristics to fix those incompatibilities. And the general, very simple primary heuristic is the following. We take the solution that we obtained by Lagrangian relaxation, we fix the decisions made by one sub-problem, and then we re-optimize the second sub-problem. So we turned the global optimization problem into a two-stage optimization problem, but in a very specific way. And we do this in such a way that we do not only get feasible solutions, but also our global valid bounds. Let's look at a few examples. These are a few examples, telecommunication networks from Berlin. And as you can see, they have different, well, they are not really small, so they have thousands of nodes and edges, and a lot of potential hub nodes, not so many central offices, onto nodes, and so on. These are just a few numbers about the objective function. They are not so important. And let's look at the results if you compare the standard approach, so just using a standard solver, and the Lagrangian relaxation solver. Maybe not with the table, but with some graphics. In each of these diagrams, you see two curves for each of those algorithms. They have, we have a minimization problem, so we have on the one hand, we have upper bounds. These are the solutions that we found. These are the solutions that we're really interested in. And we have lower bounds. Lower bounds, these are the bounds that certify the quality of the solutions. If we use the mixed integer programming, so the standard approach, then we see that the feasible solutions are quite bad at the beginning and they improve over time. At the same time, we do not know how good the solutions really are because the lower bounds are quite bad, so there's a relatively large gap in here. If we use Lagrangian relaxation, then you probably can see this, that even the initial solution is here. It is not an optimal solution, but it's already a very good solution, and the nice thing is we know that it's a very good solution because the corresponding bound is very close to the solution that we have. Here another example, here's a different example. Here the standard approach wasn't even able to find even a feasible solution at all. It has a very bad bound, but the Lagrangian relaxation approach gives us a good bound and a very good solution. So, just my last slide, a short summary. Many optimization problems, not only combinatorial optimization problems in many different applications, lead to very large optimization problems in the mathematical sense. But they are often too large for standard solvers. If they are too large, then you have to try something different. And Lagrangian decomposition is a very powerful approach that can be applied. First of all, it decomposes the problem into independent subproblems that are supposedly easier to solve. That's the one nice thing. Then the second nice thing is that the approach gives us global valid bounds. That means we do not only get solutions, we also get certificates about how good the solution is. And this is something which is very specific to mathematical optimization. This technique cannot only be used for telecommunication networks or energy networks, but also in many, many different fields of engineering. Actually, I should write energy network design down here because it has already been applied to many problems in the energy field as well. So, maybe the most important takeaway message of my talk is mathematical optimization is a powerful tool. And if you know a mathematician next door and you have never talked to him, talk to them. We have a lot of powerful tools in our belt.